The Subcommittee on Water, Power, and Oceans will come to order. The Water, Power, and Oceans Subcommittee meets today to hear testimony on two bills, H.R. 3144, sponsored by Mrs. McMorris Rodgers of Washington State, and H.R. 3916, sponsored by Mr. Calvert of California. Under Committee Rule 4F, any oral opening statements and hearings are limited to the chairman and ranking minority member and the vice chair. Therefore, I ask unanimous consent that all other members' opening statements be made part of the hearing record if they are submitted to the subcommittee clerk by 5 p.m. today. Hearing no objection, so ordered. I also ask unanimous consent that the gentleman from Washington, Mr. Newhouse, be allowed to sit in with the subcommittee and participate in the hearing. Without objection, so ordered. Welcome to the committee. You will add a lot. We will begin with opening statements, starting with myself for 5 minutes. Today, we will consider two common sense bills aimed at improving the recovery of certain Endangered Species Act listed fish species while providing certainty for water and power users. Throughout the West, federal and non-federal hydropower dams have been constructed to harness the cleanest, most efficient form of energy. Hydropower is a reliable and emissions-free source of electricity that accounts for a majority of the nation's total renewable electricity generation. Communities throughout my home state of Colorado continue to benefit immensely from this source of energy, and there are many opportunities for new hydropower development. Hydropower can and should be part of our country's all of the above energy strategy. Furthermore, with this committee advancing bipartisan proposals such as Mrs. Herrera Butler's H.R. 2083, we understand the importance of balancing salmon recovery and clean hydropower generation. We will hear from one of our witnesses today that with survival rates as high as 98% at some dams, the choice doesn't have to be dams or fish, rather both can exist and prosper in harmony. While dams provide clean, renewable energy throughout the West, they also provide other important benefits to their regions, including flood control, providing irrigation for some of the most productive agricultural areas of the nation, recreation, and allowing a navigation link to international markets for American farmers. Despite all the benefits it brings to the region, the Federal Columbia River Power System has been mired in third-party litigation, questionable judicial edicts, and onerous federal regulations for decades. The American taxpayers and Pacific Northwest ratepayers deserve better. The bipartisan legislation H.R. 3144, introduced by Mrs. McMorris Rodgers of Washington, looks to provide certainty and reliability to a hydropower system thrust into a state of legal purgatory by directing federal agencies responsible for operating the system to do so in a manner consistent with the current operation plan until certain reasonable targets are met. It is important to mention that the current operation plan was declared by the Obama administration to be legally and scientifically sound and is supported by the states of Washington, Idaho, and Montana, several tribes, and other regional stakeholders. H.R. 3916, the Federally Integrated Species Health Act, or FISH Act, introduced by Mr. Calvert of California, is the second bipartisan supported bill. I am surprised to be saying this, but former President Barack Obama summed up the need for this bill as well as any of us here could. If you take a look at our TV screens, you will see a short clip from his 2011 State of the Union address.
Then there's my favorite example. The Interior Department is in charge of salmon while they're in freshwater.
Oops. Since it's short, we'll replay
that. There's my favorite example. The Interior Department is in charge of salmon while they're in freshwater, but the Commerce Department handles them when they're in saltwater.
Okay, that was well said. That was well said. Especially the second time around, and I have to agree with President Obama on that. The FISH Act is a bipartisan solution aimed at clearing up regulatory confusion between two federal agencies. As we will hear from the bill sponsor today, this bill eliminates redundancies and overlapping jurisdiction between the Interior and Commerce Departments specific to certain Endangered Species Act listed fish species. These two agencies currently have direct jurisdiction over the ESA, and it's clear that they cannot harmonize their views on two different fish within the same watershed. It's time for a more efficient and holistic approach to manage species under one, not two, federal agencies. Clearly, the ESA process is broken, and the federal status quo isn't working for species, farmers, and ranchers and rural communities that depend on our natural resources. Under the status quo, American taxpayers and ratepayers in the Pacific Northwest and elsewhere in the West spend literally billions of dollars each year resulting from conflicting or duplicative federal regulatory or judicial edicts under the guise of the Endangered Species Act. These bills represent bipartisan, pragmatic solutions, and I want to thank Representatives Calvert and McMorris Rodgers for being here today, as well as our second panel of witnesses. I look forward to hearing from all of you. I now recognize the ranking
member. Mr. Chairman, is it appropriate for a point of order?
Yes.
I concur with many of your comments. On the video, what the President went on to say, just to highlight that, is that when Interior and Commerce are in conflict as to the jurisdiction between salmon, whether they're in saltwater and freshwater, he went on to humorously say, the salmon gets smoked. And so it's nice to have the entirety of the, we didn't get the clip there.
But, okay, well, thanks for pointing that out. And for the sake of time, we couldn't play the whole thing, but that is a that is a good statement. Thanks for adding that. Okay, I now recognize the ranking member for 5 minutes for his statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, very much. I want to cry foul for throwing our Democratic president at us up front. During today's hearing, we're going to discuss two bills that could have the consequence of undermining the Endangered Species Act. We're talking today about proposals to undermine protections for salmon and steelhead, which are extremely important to commercial, recreational, and tribal fishing interests across the country, despite the fact that our nation's salmon runs are currently at crisis levels. Just this week, we saw reports in the news that for the first time in 20 years, federal scientists surveying the Pacific Northwest salmon population have come up with empty nets. A federal scientist said this week, and I quote, "We have never hauled that net through the water looking for salmon or forage fish and not gotten a single salmon. Three times we pulled that net up and there was not a thing in it. It was alarming," end of quote. On H.R. 3144, overturn a recent federal court decision and mandate the use of an unlawful operation plan for the federal Columbia River power system. The operation plan in question has already been found insufficiently protective for fisheries and in violation of the Endangered Species Act by a federal court. The bill also blocks short-term spills over federal dams on the Lower Snake and Columbia River that are critically important for salmon survival and the fishing industry. Finally, the bill undercuts a full NEPA review that's already underway for the federal system on the Columbia by restricting the study of all reasonable salmon recovery alternatives that may reduce energy production, such as additional spills or the potential breach of select dams. Taking these options off the table before we even study the costs and benefits is misguided. The sponsor, Representative McMorris Rodgers, and I do agree that dams and fish can coexist. I heartily agree, and the debate shouldn't be about dams versus no dams, but about striking the appropriate balance between things like responsible hydropower development and sound fisheries protection. For too long, there's been an imbalance. A country built thousands of dams during the 20th century before we realized the harm they can cause to our nation's fisheries. And so today, we're left with many legacy, low-value dams that don't justify their costs to our nation's fisheries and natural resources. And as we consider what to do about these older, low-value dams, our decision-making must be guided by the best available science and a consideration of all available options. Unfortunately, H.R. 3144 takes us in the wrong direction by blocking science-based fisheries management and the study of potential changes to the status quo, which is not working for anybody on the Columbia. The second bill we're discussing today, H.R. 3916, would transfer all management of ESA-listed anadromous and catadromous fish species from NOAA Fisheries to the Secretary of Interior. And I'm going to ask our chairman to spell those words for me later. Since the Department of Interior already has sole management authority for catadromous species, such as American eels, that part of the bill can be ignored. What can't be ignored, though, is the significant negative impacts the bill could have on endangered salmon and steelhead. It is critical for federal agencies to work together to manage these species, marine fisheries, and I think with due respect to President Obama's State of the Union, there's nothing inherently wrong with moving NOAA and Fish and Wildlife Service together. I think the great objection we have is that it adds 40 new fish species and populations to Interior's responsibility without moving any of the authorizations, the funding, the budget, both either on the authorizations or the appropriation side. So we're not quite sure how Fish and Wildlife Service is going to manage these new responsibilities with an incomplete bill. So I respectfully ask my colleagues to collaborate with our federal agencies who are experts in the field rather than rushing through this legislation. I'm looking forward to a productive discussion and working towards a better balance between multiple uses on our rivers. Salmon and steelhead are really important, incredibly important to the coastal economies, and it does a disservice to all stakeholders to ignore the science and risk extinction of these species. So thank you for the members for being here today, and I look forward to all of our witnesses. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Okay, thank you. We just don't want the salmon to get smoked. Okay, we will now move to our first witness panel to hear testimony from our colleagues on their bills. As a reminder, you are limited to 5 minutes, but your written statement will appear in full in the hearing record. I now recognize Representative Calvert from California to testify on H.R. 3916.
There you go.
Unless...
I would prefer that we yield to the gentlelady from Washington.
Okay, in that case, I recognize Representative McMorris Rodgers from Washington State for 5 minutes to testify on H.R. 3144. And after you're done, if you need to go meet other obligations, you'll be excused. We will thank you in advance for your testimony, but it's up to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. Thank you to my colleague here with me. I appreciate the kind welcome. It's great to be back, and I appreciate the opportunity to be able to testify in front of this committee on which I serve for 3 terms. It's also fitting today that we're talking about this legislation on the 80th anniversary of Bonneville Power Administration, BPA. Congress created BPA in 1937 on the heels of the Great Depression to distribute the power generated from the development of 2 federally authorized dams, Bonneville and Grand Coulee Dams. These marvels of engineering provided the Pacific Northwest with the nation's most affordable, reliable, renewable energy. And still today, over 70% of Washington State's energy is powered through hydroelectricity, powering our homes, our businesses, and our communities. It was the federal power supplied by BPA that was instrumental in the ramp up of the aluminum industry that went into Boeing's B-17 and B-29 planes and powered the production of nearly 750 large ships before the end of the war. In the words of President Harry Truman, without Grand Coulee and Bonneville dams, it would have been almost impossible to win the war. It's also the building of the Columbia Snake River system that transformed the Pacific Northwest from a dry, barren sagebrush land into one of the most productive agriculture regions. Also laid the foundation, because of low-cost electricity, for our economy today, manufacturing and technology. In 1945, Congress authorized the construction of 4 large dams along the Snake River, Ice Harbor, Lower Monumental, Little Goose, and Lower Granite, to grow what we call the Federal Columbia River Power System, FCRPS. These 4 dams are able to power nearly 2 million homes, or the size of a city like Seattle. They are crucial in meeting BPA's peak loads during the hottest days in the summer, when the wind doesn't blow, or the coldest parts of winter when we have little sunlight. This year, Eastern Washington had a harsh winter with many days below freezing. During the coldest days, BPA relied on the ability of these 4 dams to ramp up production and meet demand. Without this reliable base load, I fear many in Eastern Washington would have lost power and heat. It's important to look back at this history when we think about BPA and the future of energy. BPA made its 34th constructive payment, $1.3 billion for FY17 just last week. They were able to do this because our region values low-cost, carbon-free energy. These dams average fish survival rates of 97%, despite what some say. Check the facts. And while recent warming water in the Pacific Ocean is happening, scientists call it a blob, they've slowed salmon returns recently, more total salmon have returned this year than before many of these dams were built. Over 600,000 fall Chinook are forecasted this year, many times higher than when they were first listed. I think it's important to note that of the 13 fish listed under the ESA, only 4 species pass along the Lower Snake River dams. We've also invested in tremendous research and new technologies like fish-friendly turbines, habitat restoration, and local collaboration. I mention this local collaboration because I want to quote the FCRPS Adaptive Management Implementation Plan, which was produced by the Department of Interior, BPA, the Army Corps of Engineers, and NOAA. Quote, "The Obama administration undertook an extensive effort to review the 2008 biological opinion and found the 2008 BIOP is biologically and legally sound based upon the best available scientific information and satisfies the ESA Jeopardy standard. This BIOP was supported by states, tribal entities, utilities, ports, irrigation districts, and other Pacific Northwest water users. This has been an unprecedented collaboration between these stakeholders. Unfortunately, the Oregon Federal District Court ignored these efforts, invalidated the BIOP, and set a course that will likely put BPA's future and yearly investments of hundreds of millions of dollars in fish recovery in jeopardy. BPA rates have gone up nearly 30% the last few years, 5.4% projected for both 2018 and 19. Unnecessary litigation and unnecessary spill requirements by this Oregon judge only add on to the cost. BPA has to renegotiate these contracts and are making decisions now. The needless uncertainty that continues to plague the Columbia Snake River system and the continued attacks on these lower Snake River dams have utilities looking elsewhere, and I don't blame them. That's why I've introduced this legislation to provide certainty. This bill would simply codify the current BIOP and reassert Congress's authority over the dams. Dams and fish can coexist, but we must get out of the courtroom and allow fish recovery to continue. Thank you, and I yield back.
Well, thank you for your testimony. We will give your legislation the serious and thoughtful consideration that it deserves.
Thank you, Chairman.
And you're excused if you wish to be. Thank you for being here. We will now hear from Representative Calvert from California to testify on H.R. 3916.
Thank you. Chairman Lamborn, ranking member, and members of the subcommittee, thank you for holding this hearing to discuss my legislation, H.R. 3916, the Federally Integrated Species Health Act, otherwise known as the Fish Act. It took a while to get that acronym down, but we got it. This legislation makes a fairly straightforward and common sense change to the Endangered Species Act. It's one of the few times I actually agreed with President Obama. Yet, as you all know, there's no such thing as a simple change to the Endangered Species Act. Despite this fact, I do believe that we must not be held hostage by the status quo and will continue to advocate for policy changes that can improve the ESA and advance our ability to achieve its worthwhile goals of species recovery. Currently, under the ESA, the Secretary of Interior through the United States Fish and Wildlife Service has responsibilities for plants, wildlife, and all freshwater fish. Meanwhile, the Secretary of Commerce through the National Marine Fisheries Service, NMFS, is responsible for implementing ESA with respect to saltwater fish. So we have two separate agencies implementing the same law. Our regulators fully understand which agency is responsible for each individual species. Unfortunately, these species do not live in a bubble, and often we see fish that fall under the jurisdiction of the Fish and Wildlife Service and NMFS living in the same ecosystem. There are numerous examples of how the status quo is not working. But in order to be brief, I'll focus my comments on Mr. Costa and I, our favorite subject, the California Bay Delta. The Delta is one of two major water sources for the state of California. The complex habitat has two listed species, the Delta smelt, regulated by the Fish and Wildlife Service, and the Chinook salmon, regulated by NMFS. The status of the Delta smelt, the Chinook salmon that impacts the daily operations of the Federal Central Valley Project and the State Water Project. In the case of the California Bay Delta, we have seen the negative consequences of these two agencies enforcing the same law in the form of a series of contradictory, conflicting regulations. NMFS has increasingly held more water behind Shasta Dam, for instance, to protect salmon, while Fish and Wildlife has tried to increase flows to reduce the salinity of the Delta in order to help the smelt. The goal of the Fish Act is to eliminate bureaucratic turf wars and to ensure cohesive implementation of the Endangered Species Act. The bill consolidates all ESA regulatory functions within the Fish and Wildlife Service. Currently, both fish and people are held hostage by two agencies that don't work well together with respect to the Endangered Species Act. My bill would end the situation. By creating a more unified approach that takes an all-encompassing view of species management, we can improve the ESA in a manner that benefits species as well as ESA stakeholders. By giving the Fish and Wildlife Service the sole authority to enforce ESA, we can have multi-species recovery plans that are written in a way that species management is done in concert instead of in conflict. And when problems do arise, one agency can solve these problems more quickly than two agencies. I'm grateful to have a bipartisan group of co-sponsors for the Fish Act, which includes my California colleagues, Doug LaMalfa, David Valadeo, Jim Costa, and my good friend and fellow appropriator, Mike Simpson. So these issues with appropriations, I think we can resolve. Again, thank you for holding this hearing today and your continued leadership on this complex management and species and water infrastructure. And with that, I yield back the balance of my time.
All right. Thank you for your testimony and for being here today. You're excused, and we look forward to considering your bill thoughtfully and seriously. Okay. Now I'd like to call forward our second panel of witnesses, and I will introduce the panel as they come forward and take their seats, so please come and make yourselves comfortable. Our first witness is Mr. Alan Mickelson, Acting Commissioner of the Bureau of Reclamation from Washington, D.C. Our second witness is Ms. Beth Looney, President and CEO of PNGC Power from Portland, Oregon, formerly Kansas. Our third witness is Ms. Liz Hamilton, Executive Director of the Northwest Sport Fishing Industry Association from Oregon City, Oregon. Our fourth witness is Mr. Jack Heffling, President of the United Power Trades Organization from West Richland, Washington. And our final witness is Mr. Dan Keppen, Executive Director of the Family Farm Alliance from Klamath Falls, Oregon. Thank you all for being here. Each witness's written testimony will appear in full in the hearing record. So I ask that witnesses keep their oral statements to 5 minutes, as outlined in our invitation letter to you and under Committee Rule 4A. I also want to explain how our timing lights work. When you are recognized, press the talk button to activate your microphone. Once you begin your testimony, the clerk will start the timer and a green light will appear. After 4 minutes, a yellow light will appear, and at that time, you should begin to conclude your statement. At 5 minutes, the red light will come on. You may complete your sentence, but I ask that you would stop at that point. Mr. Mickelson, you are now recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Beyer and members of the subcommittee, I am Alan Mickelson, Acting Commissioner for Bureau of Reclamation. And today I testify on behalf of Department of Interior. I prepared a written statement on H.R. 3144 and ask that it be made part of that record. And I am here to summarize the department's position in my brief remarks now. First, H.R. 3144 seeks to allow the continued operation of the Federal Columbia River Power System pending the effective date of a new biological opinion and the completion of related environmental compliance. At a time when, in our litigious society, we have practically turned over the operation of massive natural resource assets to the federal court judges, I am pleased to testify that the Department of Interior supports the goals of H.R. 3144. The Federal Columbia River Power System in our nation's Pacific Northwest consists of 31 federally owned hydroelectric power projects. This bill is focused on a subset of 14 of those dams and power plants. The largest of these is Grand Coulee Dam, the largest hydropower producer in the country, generating more than 21 billion kilowatt hours of electricity each year. Along with Hungry Horse Dam and 12 other power facilities, our smooth operation of the entire system maximizes beneficial uses of the Columbia River by generating power, protecting fish and wildlife, mitigating flood risks, providing irrigation, navigation, and sustaining cultural resources. Working through a cooperative effort of five federal agencies, the system is able to contribute about 35% of the Pacific Northwest's clean and renewable electric energy. It allows shipping access from the ocean inland to Lewiston, Idaho, a distance of 465 miles, and it provides 17 million acre-feet of water storage. Without question, the Federal Columbia River Power System is a vital component to the economic health not only of the Pacific Northwest, but the entire nation. However, since the early 1990s, biological opinions on system operations have been the subject of continuous litigation. As it stands today, the federal government is obligated by court order to prepare a new interim biological opinion to replace a 2014 biop and to do so by December 31, 2018. The court also directed federal agencies to complete a new environmental impact statement by March of 2021 and various records of decision by September of 2021. This is all in addition to a potential long-term biop to be adopted in 2022. Which will undoubtedly also be litigated. Managing the development of these numerous court-ordered measures puts a strain on our ongoing operations of the system. The aim of 3144 would be to reduce litigation and allow the cooperating federal agencies to focus on the continued operation of this vital waterway system until a new biological opinion is prepared to cover the period from 2019 to 2022. My written statement includes a section-by-section analysis of the bill, but for the sake of this testimony, let me repeat that we stand ready to work with the committee to ensure H.R. 3144 accomplishes our shared interest in providing continued stable operations of this vital system. The subcommittee is also considering H.R. 3916, and unfortunately, we do not have an OMB-approved statement for the record on that legislation at this time. I understand that we will be submitting that this afternoon. I do, of course, have extensive experience as a fishing guide in my previous retirement in our nation's Pacific Northwest, and can even discuss the difference between anadromous and catadromous fish or species in my sleep if necessary, and would be happy to take any generic questions in that regard. Mr. Chairman, again, thank you. That concludes my remarks, and I would be pleased to answer any questions the subcommittee may have on these matters.
Thank you. We now recognize Ms. Looney for 5 minutes.
Good morning, Chairman Lamborn, Ranking Member Beyer, and members of the committee. I appreciate the opportunity to testify before you today on H.R. 3144. My name is Beth Looney. I am President and CEO of PNGC Power. PNGC is a Portland, Oregon-based electric generation and transmission cooperative created and owned by 15 electric distribution cooperatives. As a not-for-profit electric cooperative, PNGC provides all the wholesale power requirements of 200,000 member homes, or roughly 500,000 individuals, farms, and businesses. PNGC is also a member of the National Rural Electric Cooperative Association, the NRECA, the service organization for America's electric cooperatives. In addition to my role at PNGC Power, I also serve on the board of directors of Northwest River Partners, an alliance of utilities, farmers, ports, and businesses that promote the economic and environmental benefits of the Columbia and Snake Rivers. River Partners' 120-member organization represents more than 4 million electric utility customers, 40,000 farmers, thousands of port employees, and large and small businesses that provide hundreds of thousands of Northwest jobs. My goal in providing testimony today is to inform you of an issue that weighs heavily in my mind and in the minds of those public power utilities in the Northwest. In 1991, the first salmon species was listed endangered under the ESA in the Columbia River Basin. Since that time, the cost to mitigate for these now 13 species has been placed upon the Bonneville Power Administration, the federal power marketing agency for the hydro dams located in the basin. Bonneville passes through all of their costs, including these fish mitigation costs, to their power customers. About 80% of PNGC's power supply comes from Bonneville. Since Bonneville makes up such a large portion of PNGC's total power supply costs, I'm concerned about its rates. In fiscal year 2016 alone, Bonneville reported total fish and wildlife costs of approximately $622 million in 1 year, each year. Bonneville reported, this makes up about a third of Bonneville's total cost of power, a third. In fact, Bonneville's customers fund the largest mitigation effort for threatened and endangered species in the nation. PNGC and Northwest River Partners are delighted that positive biological results have been attained due to these monumental efforts to mitigate for these species. However, despite these efforts, Bonneville, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, the Bureau of Reclamation, and NOAA are continually hauled into court by plaintiffs with an agenda who place no value on federal science conducted primarily under both the Bush and Obama administrations. Now, yet again, due to plaintiff-filed motions for injunctive relief, the U.S. Court for the District of Oregon is likely to order increased spill over the dams for the 2018 migration season. It is expected that this $40 million spill experiment will cost Bonneville customers another 2% power rate increase. This 2% is on top of a 5.4% rate increase ushered in last week, and on top of an additional 30% rate increase that was been brought in over the past several years. You know, my rural customers cannot dig any deeper. They are already just barely getting by. Even more concerning than the recent large rate increases is the potential for future rate increases. As outlined in my written statement, if Bonneville's rates continue to climb at their current trajectory, they will likely not be competitive with alternative power supply choices in the region. If Bonneville's customers choose more cost-effective options, Bonneville will not have a sufficient consumer base to cover its costs, costs that include the Fish and Wildlife Program. It also puts at risk Bonneville's ability to make its annual payment to the U.S. Treasury, which would negatively affect the nation's taxpayers. PNGC values the clean, carbon-free, flexible hydropower resources that Bonneville provides. However, I have a responsibility to supply power to my members at an affordable rate, whether that comes from Bonneville or elsewhere. So why am I supporting this bill? This bill keeps in place current biological measures vetted by the top federal scientists that protect salmon in the Columbia and Snake Rivers until a court-ordered review of federal hydro system operations is complete. It effectively puts a timeout on litigation so that federal agencies can do the environmental review work the judge has asked them to do without being sidetracked and burdened with litigation expenses and activities. When this work is complete, the agencies will be positioned to adopt a new salmon plan based on public, transparent NEPA process and the science it yields. Thank you, and I welcome any questions you may have.
All right, thank you. Ms. Hamilton, you are now recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chair Lambert and Ranking Member Beyer, subcommittee members. I appreciate the opportunity to speak with you this morning regarding H.R. 3144. It's really an honor to testify before a subcommittee with members from the top sport fishing states in the nation. It means you recognize and appreciate the economic value and the tens of thousands of jobs that it sustains. I have the good fortune of serving as the executive director of the Northwest Sport Fishing Industry Association, a trade group of over 300 members. Our businesses are concentrated in the Northwest, but include many companies from across the country. Northwest Sport Fishing sustains 34,500 family wage jobs, serves over 2 million adult customers and children, and contributes nearly $4 billion in economic activity. While salmon and steelhead mean business in the Pacific Northwest, our clients are apprehensive about the future, and this bill is a part of that concern. If it becomes law, it will lock in an expensive status quo that has failed salmon, it's failed fishery-dependent businesses, and rural economies. It entrenches an approach that isn't working for fish, fishing businesses, or for that matter, energy consumers, shippers, or growers. The 8 federal dams on the Columbia and Snake Rivers inflict tremendous harm to salmon and steelhead fisheries, affecting the bottom line for the businesses that depend on this valuable and renewable resource. We know dams and their reservoirs are the salmon's main cause of human-caused mortality, the main source. As far back as the 90s, though, NSIA and the fishermen we work with recognize that spilling water over the tops of dams rather than sending it through the turbines led to higher adult returns. So in 2005, we secured guaranteed spill through a court order. The fish responded immediately and delivered big benefits to our industry. By 2012, Snake River fall Chinook returns had tripled. In 2013, 1.2 million fall Chinook returned to the Columbia and business was booming. Columbia River fall Chinook fed fisheries from Alaska to California in the ocean and inland from Oregon to Washington and Idaho. The evidence was indisputable that spill works. Science shows that additional spill can triple returns. We want to repeat this success of the fall Chinook with the Snake River spring Chinook, which are currently in deep decline. As the first salmon of the season, spring Chinook are highly prized by anglers who want to get out on the water after being cooped up all winter. They buy licenses, they buy new gear, they fill their gas tanks, load their coolers, book a guide, hook a hotel, and hit the river, spending roughly $115 each in trip expenditures. But what's so remarkable about spring Chinook is that it takes 8 anglers on the water for one to go home in a creel. So this makes one spring salmon worth $900 in direct trip expenditures. These fish are worth their weight in gold, sending money to rural communities from Astoria, Oregon to Riggins, Idaho. The recent judge's order to put a process in place is finally breaking through the logjam. Parties are collaboratively working together on sensible river operations that will help fish and our businesses. Hundreds of thousands of citizens have actively engaged with their government through the NEPA process. Unfortunately, HR 3144 goes in reverse, rolling back protections and poisoning this collaborative effort. It locks into place the old illegal plan through 2022, denying citizens their day in court. HR 3144 would also hamstring processes that allow citizens to protect their interests in these fish. It undermines the current NEPA review by prohibiting federal agencies from fully studying true costs and benefits of all the recovery alternatives. Salmon need more help now, not less. Poor ocean conditions combined with poor river conditions are hammering some of these stocks. We can't control the ocean, but we can take steps to improve river conditions for salmon, and spill is our most effective near-term tool. NSIA business members, leaders focused on the bottom line, are frustrated by a bill that limits options, reverses the courts, and is bad for business. It's a bad ROI. Again, our industry members oppose HR 3144 because it interferes with a process that is working at a time when salmon declines are on the front page. Salmon restoration has been an expensive failure, but we are finally getting on the right track to address harmful dam operations. We respectfully urge this committee to reject a bill that ignores the science, does not solve the problem, throws good money after bad. The fish and our sport fishing businesses hope we deserve better. And I appreciate any questions you may have.
Thank you. Mr. Heffling, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Chairman Lamborn, ranking member Byer, subcommittee members, thank you for allowing me to testify. I am honored to speak on behalf of the United Power Trades Organization, which represents over 600 highly skilled operation and maintenance employees who work at the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers hydroelectric projects in Portland, Seattle, and Walla Walla districts of the Northwest Division. The dams of the Columbia Snake River system are considered multi-purpose in that they provide hydropower.
Sir, could you put the microphone just a little bit closer?
Sure.
Thank you.
That they provide hydropower, flood control, navigation, irrigated agriculture, and recreation to the areas where they are located. Hydropower is clean, renewable, and plays a significant role in Pacific Northwest power production. Only hydropower has the instantaneous capability to meet peak demands. Navigation is a major benefit of the Columbia Snake River system of dams and provides a vital transportation link for the states of Idaho, Montana, Oregon, and Washington. Irrigated agriculture is the economic powerhouse of the West, with a net value to all Western states of over $60 billion. It is the dams that provide the water for irrigation and, as a direct result, help sustain the economy of the Northwest. Removal of the Snake River dams would be a detriment to large amount of irrigated agriculture, would eliminate barging from Pasco, Washington to Lewiston, Idaho, and would damage the electrical infrastructure that relies on the generating units, not only for power production, but for reactive support to help stabilize the electrical grid of the Northwest. Studies have shown that the survival rate of salmon migrating through the Lower Snake dams is equal to, or sometimes even better than, the survival rate of fish migrating rivers without dams. These studies have also shown that juvenile salmon transported by fish barge survive at 5 times the rate of those that were not barged. This information strongly contradicts any claims by environmental groups that the removal of the dams is necessary for fish to survive and that barging juvenile salmon through the dams is ineffective. Studies have shown that the vast majority of juvenile fish migrating downstream are near the surface, so screens at the intakes of the generators are positioned to direct them into bypass channels where they are collected for barge transport or bypassed back to the river. Weirs are in place on spillways that allow for spilling water directly from the surface, thus providing another effective bypass for juvenile fish traveling downstream. It is existence of these spillway weirs that make any additional spilling unnecessary and in fact can have an adverse effect on fish due to the increase in dissolved gases that result when spilling from bays that don't have spillway weirs. Because of the pressure from outside interests, additional spill is ordered that requires spill through spill gates that don't have the fish slides installed. This forces the fish down through restricted openings at the bottom of the spill gates, which is not only harmful to the fish in transition, but causes significant increase in the supersaturation of nitrogen in the water, resulting in gas bubble trauma. Fish passage plans, also known as the fish biological opinion, or BIOP, are in place at each facility and overseen by federal and state biologists to assure that hydro plants are operated in criteria most advantageous to fish passage. It is extremely important that the current BIOP is not deviated from in order to continue the success that has been the result of this fish passage plan. H.R. 3144 would ensure that it does remain in place until replaced by a new BIOP that is based on science. The residents of the Northwest have made their opinion clear. Results of a poll administered in 2015 show that they recognize hydropower generated by the Northwest dams is a renewable energy source and that dams and salmon can coexist. In summary, the BIOP is working, is the most scientifically sound plan that can be incorporated, and no pressure from outside interest groups should change that. The Snake River dams are irreplaceable and are important not only to the people that live in our area, but to the Northwest as a whole. It took an act of Congress to get these dams constructed. It should require an act of Congress to remove them. Thank you again for this opportunity to testify, and I look forward to any questions.
Thank you. Mr. Keppen, you are now recognized for 5 minutes.
Chairman Lamborn, Ranking Member Beyer, and subcommittee members, good morning. Mr. Chairman and Mr. Costa kind of stole my thunder. I'm going to restate the President's State of the Union quote. It's my attention getting device for my statement today. So what he said, again, was the Interior Department is in charge of salmon while they're in freshwater, but the Commerce Department handles them when they're in saltwater. And I hear it gets even more complicated once they're smoked. That was the full quote. I remember it. This moment may have provided the first widespread public awareness of the absurdity in having multiple federal agencies responsible for enforcing the Federal Endangered Species Act. The Alliance, Family Farm Alliance, who I represent, supports H.R. 3916. This bill would combine the ESA responsibilities of both the National Marine Fisheries Service and the Fish and Wildlife Service under one federal roof. This would promote more efficient, effective, and coordinated management of all ESA responsibilities for anadromous and freshwater fish in western watersheds from the highest reaches of our headwaters to the Pacific Ocean. Many western irrigators operate in watersheds that provide habitat for threatened and endangered species protected by the ESA. These producers can be significantly impacted by decisions made by the fisheries agencies. Western watersheds that drain to the Pacific Ocean are home to many species of fish. Some of these species are listed as endangered or threatened under the ESA. However, within this group, some fall under the responsibility of National Marine Fisheries Service, and others are overseen by Fish and Wildlife Service. Because they can have different migration patterns or life histories, what can result is duplicative and sometimes overlapping actions by each of the agencies under the Endangered Species Act. The scope of similar or identical ESA actions performed by each agency can be extensive. Designation of critical habitat, development of species recovery plans and conservation programs, consultation activities, to name just a few. These functions would most effectively and efficiently be conducted under the roof of one government agency. Instead, as things currently stand, they appear to be arbitrarily split between two different agencies housed in two completely different federal departments. So, up and down the West Coast, duplicative bureaucracies are generating ESA plans that sometimes compete with one another. In my written testimony, I touched on specific examples, including the Klamath Project in California and Oregon, where I live, California Central Valley Project, where I used to live, and the Upper Snake River in Idaho. In the Klamath example, the two federal regulatory agencies each adopted a single-minded and uncoordinated approach of focusing on Klamath Project operations. One sought to artificially create high reservoir levels for endangered suckers. The other called for artificially high reservoir releases for threatened salmon. Unfortunately, both agencies did so independent of one another. Based on those regulatory actions, the Bureau of Reclamation announced in 2001 that for the first time ever, no water would be available from Upper Klamath Lake to supply project irrigators or the National Wildlife Refuges. The combined lake level and outflow regulatory requirements equated to a volume of water that was more than what was available. The resulting impacts to the local community were immediate and far-reaching, as detailed in my written testimony. A Klamath-like situation with potential dire consequences for Idaho water exists in the Snake River Basin. National Marine Fisheries Service Biological Opinion, or BIOP, for the Upper Snake River Basin projects requires that water be sent downstream for salmon flow augmentation. The Fish and Wildlife Service BIOP for bull trout critical habitat requires bank full reservoirs in one of the Upper Snake projects. When push comes to shove, Idaho water users wonder how they will do both and still provide water for farms and communities. Water users served by California Central Valley Project, or CVP, face a similar dilemma. Simply put, the Delta Smelt BIOP prepared by Fish and Wildlife Service requires flushing flows released from storage to influence smelt habitat. At the same time, the National Marine Fisheries Service BIOP for salmon requires keeping water in storage for temperature control. A committee convened by the National Research Council studied this matter a few years ago. The NRC found that the lack of a systematic, well-framed overall analysis between the two services is, quote, a serious scientific deficiency, and it likely is related to the ESA's practical limitations as to the scope of actions that can or must be considered in a single biological opinion, unquote. H.R. 3916 addresses these limitations and clears the way for improved Bay Delta ESA management. This bill is an important step in reducing wasted time and money and represents a practical, common-sense approach to the ESA that my membership strongly supports. Family Farm Alliance stands ready to aid the committee on advancement of H.R. 3916 and other measures to update and modernize the ESA. Thank you, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
All right, thank you, and thank you all for your testimony and for being here today. At this point, we will begin our questions for the witnesses to allow all of our members to participate and to ensure we can hear from all of our witnesses today. Under Committee Rule 3D, members are limited to 5 minutes for their questions. And I will begin, and then we'll hear from the ranking member and so on. Ms. Looney, as we've heard today, the operations of the Federal Columbia River Power System have been clouded with uncertainty for decades. During this period, the people who are impacted the most are the region's taxpayers, whose electricity bills continue to increase with negative impacts on the economy and on working families. Much of this uncertainty can be attributed to the litigation and the court mandates that have micromanaged the system's operations. Do you believe that having the courts running the dams is good for ratepayers and species?
No, I do not believe that having the courts run the dam is good for ratepayers or for the species. You know, one of the things that concerns me most about this issue is the decisions that I'm going to have to make in the next couple of years. As Bonneville's fourth largest customer, in the next 4 to 5 years, we'll be making a decision about whether we go under a new contract with Bonneville for power supply post-2028. And Right now, their cost trajectory is greater than the available resources that I can buy. In my testimony, I indicated that I buy 80% of my power from Bonneville, and I buy the other 20% at a third cheaper. And when you think about what's going on in the Northwest markets, all the fundamentals are there, and what's driving Bonneville's costs are predominantly the costs associated with mitigating for fish, which is about 30% of my total wholesale power supply cost.
If I could jump in right there.
Yes, sir.
Because I have a limited time. If Bonneville has to, if you have to, as the fourth biggest customer, have to buy from other sources, where does that electricity from other sources come from? Does it come from clean hydropower?
It can, yes. We actually buy a lot of power from Canada. So if we pick up from their hydro systems in the north, we can buy from there. We can buy from renewable resources that are in place in the Northwest, and we can also buy from California. So there's a plentiful supply in the region.
But do you sometimes have to buy from either nuclear or fossil fuel sources?
Sometimes we have undesignated resources that we'll purchase, but for the most part, we do know where that power supply is coming from, and it is renewable.
Now, when there are spillovers that are mandated, that is lost hydropower potential. Where does Bonneville get its replacement electricity to supply its contractual obligations when water has been flowing over, spilling over without generating any electricity?
Bonneville, too, must buy that power from the same available sources in the region in order to cover their obligations to their preference customers.
Mr. Heffling, if I could ask you a question. Are the arguments in favor of species mitigation entirely reasonable on your part, or is there a possibility that some people have an ulterior motive in wanting to make dams unprofitable so they'll, in their dreams, have to be torn down?
Yes, I believe I've seen testimony or talked to environmental groups that are just made up of attorneys that earn their living by suing the federal government. And I believe that's all there is left on tearing down these Snake River dams. It's already been proven that the fish and the dams can coexist, and I see no reason for outside interests to influence that.
Well, it sounds to me like that's an abuse of the Endangered Species Act, and it's for an ulterior, unrevealed, and hidden motive. Would you agree with that?
I would agree. We've had judges, I think, that have been influenced by bad information and myths and just bad scientific data or manipulated data that doesn't present the facts as they are.
And Mr. Keppen, would you care to weigh in on that same question?
Yeah, well, you know, our organization has been all about trying to find constructive ways to make the ESA work better, and litigation and some of these sort of backroom settlements that involve a lot of Western species need some attention. I'm glad this committee has paid attention to that and has offered some bills to deal with it.
All right, well, thank you all for being here and for your valuable testimony. At this point, I'll yield to the ranking member for any questions he might have.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to begin with a simple statement that I love hydropower. As someone who thinks that all the science on climate change is real, developing hydropower is very important for us.
That's right.
Mr. Mickelson, you know, so we have this balance of power, the executive, the congressional, the judicial. The District Court of Oregon ruled that the 2014 buyout was arbitrary and capricious. It said that the current dam operations under the 2014 biological opinion cannot ensure the survival or recovery of the fish and are vastly unresponsive to their current biological needs. And we did hear that there were thousands of pages of testimony in a long hearing. Why was there no appeal? If the science was bad, if the ruling was bad, why not appeal to a higher court? And why instead take a legislative approach for something that would probably pass this House and be dead on arrival in the Senate?
I would have to defer the question on why there was no appeal to the Department of Justice on that, sir.
I just find it curious. Ms. Hamilton, in your testimony, you said, quote, existing salmon policies have already wasted more than $10 billion on a series of insufficient measures that have failed to recover a single one of the 13 protected populations of salmon and steelhead. And yet, Member McMorris Rodgers talked about 96% recovery. Ms. Looney talks about 96 to 98% performance standard testing. How do you reconcile these 96 to 98% numbers with your concern that they failed to, and even, in fact, your notion that you had 1.27 million salmonids coming up? You know, you can't rent a boat for 6 months. So,
those numbers were results from a spill program that was put in place by the court. Unfortunately, we could not get the agencies to support that without presenting our science in front of the court. I'll give you an analogy about what the 97% means, and it's variable at the different dams, but let's say you had to go through 10 toll booths. And at every toll booth, I took 5% of your money. So by the time you got to the bottom of 10 toll booths, I've got quite a bit of your money in my pocket. So that's one example. The other thing is that you're running out of gas as you slow down to go through each one of those. And that's what happens to the baby salmon. They lose energy by the time they get to the ocean to go back to that. So when we measure concrete to concrete, it's like saying, okay, on an assembly line, I put in 35 bolts in your car, but I'm not responsible for whether the car runs or not. So measuring babies past concrete is not measuring adults back. So the way we get smolt to adult returns is by spill. It's been monitored and measured for over two decades, and that's what we know about spill and the benefits of it.
You, perfect transition, because you in your text and your speech, you write extensively about how effective spills are. Well, let me quote Mr. Heffling. I'm just going to, when fish are transitioned via spill, less are collected for transport via the barge transport system. Barge survive at five times the rate as those that traverse the river. Spilled fish are more susceptible to predatory birds and fish that congregate below the spillways. And it doesn't help the fish and may even have a negative effect on fish survival. How do you respond to his criticisms of spills in fish?
Well, again, we've got a decades-long study that looks at fish that are spilled, fish that are put in barges, fish that are bypassed through these Rube Goldberg slides. And what the data shows is year in and year out, we get more adults back by spilling them over the tops of the dams. It's just the best methodology that we have.
And this is measuring at the end point. When they hit the ocean.
I mean, do you want your car to drive or do you want 35 bolts in it, right? What we want are adults back. And when there's overwhelming evidence that spilling gets the adults back, that's the important part. When I mentioned that we noticed this in the 90s, it wasn't based on studies. It was fishermen who watched the river. And we noticed on years of high spill from overgeneration mostly, which is what the spring is like in the Northwest. It's a lot of overgen. Got a lot of dams, a lot of water. What we noticed is we got a lot of adult returns back. So simple fishermen were noticing something that decades later science has really proved out.
Great. Thank you very much. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you. Representative Webster.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. A couple of questions I had you've asked, and I appreciate that. I'd like to go into that further, though. Ms. Looney, what is the, when you have to go out and buy power from some other source other than your current source, what's the price per kilowatt difference or percentage or something like that?
So on Monday, we purchased fiscal year 2019 around the clock for $22.60, and Bonneville is currently at $37. So it's about a third cheaper.
Yeah. So is there a potential, I guess, if you were to, say, eliminate all that power and you had to go somewhere else, is there enough available, enough surplus available? Is there potential brownouts, or what would be the result?
If, being the fourth largest customer, there's enough available for me. But if the other three large customers decide that they want to pay a third less as well, and we all go out looking for additional power, it would put pressure on the availability in the region.
From a capacity standpoint?
Correct.
Okay. Thank you, Chair. I would like to yield the rest of my time to Mr. LaMaffa.
Thank you, Mr. Webster. I appreciate this legislation brought forward by Mr. Calvert, and certainly will provide clarity on on how people are supposed to manage water supplies. Indeed, Shasta Dam and Shasta Lake are in my district, as much of the Sacramento STEM is, and to have competing agencies at opposite with opposite missions, one saying we need to let more water out of the dam for fisheries, and the other one saying we need to keep more water in the dam for cold water later in the year, really puts people in conflict. And the people caught in the middle are the customers, including much of ag that depends on Sacramento River water. Just in one of these hearing rooms a year or two ago, it was unsure whether how full the lake would have to be before spring releases would be released to agriculture. And so how is any farmer or any other water user supposed to make a plan with their lenders or anybody else when the federal government cannot get its act together to decide whether water is going to be released or kept behind the lake, kept behind the dam for cold water? So, but it's interesting on the panel today, much discussion about keeping dams in place and dam removal, fish being able to coexist with dams. And we have a very hot issue up in the north part of my district, as well as part of Oregon and Mr. Walden's district, with the hell-bent effort to remove four dams on the Klamath River with very, I think, incomplete science. Incomplete is being generous on that. Yet we've seen little change in the direction of that in this new administration, and my constituents are very disappointed that they're not being heard on this. Mr. Mickelson, you completed another tour of the area, I think, 2 days ago, and heard from constituents. They don't feel like they're being heard. And you've sent a response letter to us. To my initial letter, it was sent to Secretary Zinke, that basically said, we received your letter, and we all need to work together. But some of the important topics that I brought up in that letter have to do with the process of the facilitators there for the previous secretary's approval of the Klamath Dam removal, yet some very important information was ignored. Did you get a chance, Mr. Mickelson, to review the letter that in our previous meeting about a week and a half ago from Mr. Paul Hauser, whose credentials include being the science advisor for the Bureau of Reclamation or the scientific integrity officer previously for the Bureau of Reclamation as well? Did you get a chance to review that document?
Yes, sir.
Previously, the one when we met, you got a chance to look at the Hauser document about the subject being the allegation of scientific and scholarly misconduct in reprisal for a disclosure concerning the biased summarization of key scientific conclusions for the Klamath River Dam removal secretarial determination process. That document?
Yes.
And later on, Mr. Hauser was dismissed for his role in that because it seems that his goals with that were just scientific. He wasn't biased on this, but he was the scientific goals did not go with Secretary Salazar's desire announced before the science to remove the dams. So did you get a chance to review this today or previously when I asked you to?
I have reviewed what Mr. Hauser's allegations were and the response of the Independent Science Review Panel.
Okay, my time is over for now. Yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, Representative Costa.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member, for holding this important subcommittee hearing. And also I want to thank Congressman Ken Calvert for his efforts on this legislation, of which I'm a co-sponsor. Because it really builds upon our previous efforts that include the WIND Act that we passed last December that provides greater flexibility for 5 years, plus authorizing four different reservoir storage facilities in California and a lot of other good things. But let me just really explain this to the members of the subcommittee, because the legislation that Mr. Calvert has introduced that we are co-sponsoring is all about common sense and logic, which too often gets lost in Congress. And let me give you an anecdotal story to point this out. The legislation that created NOAA was back in 1973 during the Nixon administration, okay? And there was bipartisan support for creating NOAA. And the Secretary of Interior at the time happened to be Wally Hickel, who was a former governor of Alaska. And the Secretary of Interior made some comments that were in disagreement with the President on Vietnam. And the President was furious. Sound familiar? Cabinet Secretary said something he didn't like. And so President Nixon said, the only way I'm going to approve NOAA, I don't want to see it in Interior. So the compromise was, let's put it in Commerce. Okay, that's how this happened. That's how this happened. So we get stuck in our own positions here, but that's the real story. And so what we're trying to do is make some common sense out of this, common sense and logic. Now, Mr. Kepin, you mentioned in your testimony that many areas across the country have faced duplicative and often conflictive actions proposed by U.S. Fish and Wildlife and NOAA fisheries in an attempt to preserve and ultimately recover species that are listed under the Endangered Species Act. And that's true. I've experienced that in California and other parts of the country. The fact is that the conflicting operational decisions, for example, have impacted areas like the Sacramento-San Joaquin Delta area, as Congressman Calvert mentioned earlier, as well as in Ventura County, where we have, again, these conflicts with NOAA, prioritizing keeping water upstream reservoirs for temperature management, while the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service proposes releasing significant volumes of water downstream for experiments to increase the recovery of species. I mean, they're not on the same page. The duplicative and inconsistent management regimes makes no logical sense, and it harms the communities in the San Joaquin Valley and across the nation, and it does nothing, beg to differ with you, for helping the recovery of the species. It seems to me if they're in the same department, as President Obama suggested, and they're talking to each other, they could be on the same page with the biologists and the other folks that are managing the species. Last year alone, with the greatest rain and snowpack in California ever recorded, which came on the heels of the worst five-year drought in history, we had these conflicting actions taking place, unfortunately, too often. Non-senior water right holders across California that ended up preventing plantings and negatively impacting the economy that I felt in my district, as well as in Congressman Denham's district. Congressman LaMoffa's constituents, as he pointed out, were impacted. Congressman Denham's constituents were impacted by the damages of this. I mean, we argued last year between August and September between releasing water as to whether or not it was at 56 degrees temperature or whether it was at 55 degrees temperature, which was better for the recovery of the salmon, which then was in conflict with the other agency for the recovery of the Delta smelt. It makes no sense. So this bill, while a far cry from what I would like to see, which is that NOAA fisheries is respectively management budget being moved in the Department of Interior, and that was mentioned earlier by the ranking member, but I think we can work that out. That's not rocket science. That's doable. Would provide consistent regulatory action for all species with a portion of their life cycle in inland waters. Additionally, these conflicting requirements could be reduced and even eliminated through an integrated biological opinion for smelt, Chinook salmon, steelhead, which NOAA Fisheries is resistant to developing, despite, as Mr. Kepin said, the National Research Council stating that that would lead to a preferable outcome. I have a couple questions. I don't have much time. Mr. Kepin, can you provide an example of how the integrated biological opinion in the Klamath, as a comparison, has functioned more effectively than what we've had with separate biological opinions in the Sacramento-San Joaquin Delta?
Sure, Congressman Costa. So I believe this is kind of a new development. My testimony focused on what happened in 2001, and we began to get all kinds of national attention dealing with that issue because the National Academy of Sciences actually got involved there too, came back and said the decisions that were made by both agencies weren't completely justified. So I think as far as oh, I'm sorry, I lost my train of thought all of a sudden. I was thinking about Klamath. Your question was?
It says having one biological opinion for the entirety of, as you have the Klamath versus
having multiple
biological opinions of the Sacramento-San Joaquin Delta.
Yeah, so they've done it in Klamath the last several years. It took a couple of years to develop. I think it's actually the first joint biological opinion between Fish and Wildlife Service and National Marine Fisheries Service that's been conducted in the West. And my understanding is it is operating better. It has been litigated, but even with that said, I'm not quite sure that it would be as efficient as having both agencies under the same roof.
Which you could then better more logically produce and reproduce on the life cycle of the species.
Right, right.
Absolutely. Common sense, logic.
Right.
That's what this is about.
Representative Gosar.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Hamilton, for full public disclosure, you and your association are currently one of the current plaintiffs in the Federal Columbia River Power System litigation that has challenged multiple federal dam biological opinions over the past two decades or so. Is that correct?
Yes, sir, we are.
Thank you. Now, in January of this year, you said, and I quote, gold plating dams that may not be in our future because they're outdated. They've outlived their purpose, and they're causing, most of us think, more harm than good. Then we need to stop investing in them. It's just a waste of money, end of quote. I kind of find it interesting. Most of us, I'm not one of them. Now, I understand that just four ESA-listed subspecies of salmon migrate through the Snake River dams, and at least nine other populations flow through other federal and non-federal dams on the Columbia, including Bonneville Dam and several public utility district-owned dams. Do you believe that all the federal and non-federal power-producing dams on the Columbia River system are outdated and a waste of time? And do you believe that they should all be removed? And if not, which one should stay and why? Are they the ones that are okay?
Thank you for the question. Yes, when I see the four lower Snake River dams are remanded to be reviewed for costs and benefits, then I disagree, and our organization disagrees, with spending money for them to stay in place while the studies are in place. That said, we're pretty optimistic about the benefits of spill, and so I'm not sure that this dams versus salmon debate or the environment versus jobs debate aren't false choices. So we're keenly interested in seeing how spill works.
Well, for clarity here, I'm also a fisherman. In fact, my first job was a fly tying as a small child, so from that standpoint. For the rest of the panel, we'll go in reverse order from the right to the left. The Federal Dams, Federal Power Act, and a number of other laws require congressional authorization, meaning that they are longstanding policies affecting these dams. Do you believe Congress should continue to have this authority relative to the federal, Columbia, and Snake River dams, starting from the right and moving back?
Yes, I agree with that position. Thank you.
Gentleman to the right. Young lady?
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you. I'm going to yield the rest of my time to Mr. LaMalfa.
Thank you, Mr. Gosar. Coming back to Mr. Mickelson on that, you've told me and then several others up in the district there that you really have a pretty keen interest in the situation up at Klamath, and I think you told Secretary Zinke that you wouldn't come back to Washington, D.C. From retirement unless you got to handle basically the Klamath project. What is your particular interest in the Klamath Dam removal project that you have so that would hinge on taking the acting role?
I would say that's probably a bit of a mischaracterization of any communication I had with the secretary on that particular
issue. Well, that's what you tell people in the district, so, okay.
I have said that I volunteered for the Klamath as a matter of professional interest because I have about 35 years of experience with respect to conflict resolution on natural resource issues.
Does conflict resolution involve listening closely to both sides of an issue?
Yes.
Okay. The people that are opposed to dam removal still don't believe they're being heard up there as a result of a couple of tours recently. So I asked you about the Hauser document a few minutes ago. What did you conclude from the charges brought forth by Mr. Hauser, who again was summarily dismissed when his views didn't seem to line up with the previous administration on the science involved with the dam removal? What did you conclude from that document? It was submitted February 24th, 2012.
The Hauser document referred to a criticism of a departmental press release, as I understand it, and in response to all of the allegations that were made here by Mr. Hauser, the department did institute an independent science review panel that went through that, and the science review panel did criticize the press release and how the press release was handled with respect to the specificity of some numbers, but they also upheld the department's action in doing so. And that was an independent
press release
science review panel.
That's over a press release. Well, I'll continue. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, and you'll have some time in a moment, but first we'll hear questions from Mrs. Bordaio.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank the committee for being here this morning. My questions are for you, Commissioner Mickelson, and this is for the record. In 1986, Congress added Texas and the insular areas as reclamation states. Commissioner Mickelson, are you aware that Guam is eligible for reclamation funding and has been for 3 decades, 30 years? Yes?
Yes, I am.
All right.
That Public Law 99-396 added that.
All right, thank you. Question two, can you pledge that reclamation will provide all due consideration to any funding requests from eligible applicants on Guam, including our government agency, the Guam Water Works Authority? Is it yes or no?
Yes.
Yes.
I mean, to the point that understand that reclamation's grant program is a competitive process.
Right. My third question, many are surprised to learn that tropical islands can face water supply challenges, including groundwater contamination and even drought. Are you willing to explore how reclamation's expertise can help Guam and other insular areas to further improve their public water systems and better manage water resources?
The short answer to that is yes. I would note that we have had one application from a territory in the Northern Mariana Islands that was selected for our Water Smart grants. They're using about $300,000 in federal funding with another $300,000 in local funding to install 1,000 new advanced water meters for both agriculture and domestic customers. And I would say that entities that are located in the territories listed are also eligible for all those other parts of Water Smart Title 16 cooperative watershed management programs, but we've not received applications for funding from the U.S. territories for those particular programs.
Thank you. Thank you, Commissioner. I just wanted this on record. Lastly, I am pleased that this committee and our chairman have committed to do all that we can within our jurisdiction to help Puerto Rico and the U.S. Virgin Islands as they rebuild from recent hurricanes. Will you pledge, Commissioner, that reclamation will do its part by providing all due consideration to any funding request from eligible applicants on the Virgin Islands? Congress made the U.S. Virgin Islands eligible for reclamation funding back in 1986.
That's correct, under Public Law 99-396. And as required by statute, reclamation does use a competitive process to identify those projects for grant programs, and each application will be thoroughly reviewed and scored in a described manner that everybody has access to.
Thank you. Thank you, Commissioner. Mr. Chairman, I make these, I ask these questions because many times the territories are forgotten. And you've been on Guam, so you know how far we are and the needs that come about just like any other state.
Many times, and I think that's always been at your invitation.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Mr. Chairman, I do have, I'd like to enter into the record my comments on H.R. 3916.
With no objection, so ordered.
Thank you, and I yield back.
Representative LaMalfa.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll resume with that letter with Mr. Mickelson here. In order to get it on the record here, two of the charges Mr. Hauser made in submitting that letter, one was, number one, intentional falsification, motivated by Secretary Saldar's publicly stated 2009 intention to issue a secretarial determination in favor of removing four dams on the Klamath River, which was due March 31, 2012. The Department of the Interior has followed a course of action to construct support for such an outcome. An example of this intentional bias falsification reporting of scientific results is contained in the September 21, 2011 called Summary of Key Conclusions, Draft EIS EIR, and Related Scientific Technical Reports. Other examples are provided by third parties. So you talk about the press release. Yes, that isn't included in the second portion of the letter. And I will conserve time on that. But what we have is a problem here is that the science involved is not being taken into account by an unbiased party here. Indeed, it looks like a conclusion that is being carried forward, unfortunately, under this administration's officers. Are you aware also of another document submitted by a gentleman named Stephen Koshy that would talk about the deconstruction of the earthen dams, the Iron Gate and the J.C. Boyle Dam, that are were reviewed by people that have not experience with earthen dams, with concrete dams. This document talks about the technical aspects of removing a dam that has a clay core with a gravel and other material covering that. The peril of removing such a dam and the expertise that was submitted by people that have no experience with that, indeed are people that were that reviewed that and said it was okay, are folks that are from this letter was submitted to a Thomas Hepler, who's the team leader of Waterways and Concrete Dam Group in Denver, Colorado. The letter talks about stability of slopes in deconstructing these earthen dams, where you have 174 feet that has been underwater for a very long time, and that the drawdown on that would have an effect on slope stability, therefore collapsing into the river, as well as the, I can't go into all the technical aspects of the clay core of the dams, but the issues involved with the clay causing collapse once the water starts to inundate that, even after the dam drawdown has been completed. Has that been taken into account in the deconstruction process of the two earthen dams on the system?
Reclamation is not involved in the removal of these dams, and so I would probably have to refer that question to the KRRC as successor in interest to Pacific Corps, sir.
Okay, well, it evidently has not been. So one of my requests I made of the secretary early on in this administration in April in a letter was one of three things. And that would include, since the science is incomplete by many different accounts, I requested the secretary to withdraw the previous secretary's approval of the Klamath Dam removal and inform Federal Energy Regulatory Commission of the withdrawal, so decisions aren't made without all the science. Indeed, it was 20 million cubic yards of material sitting behind the four dams that would then infect the rest of the river after they're removed. That's been completely glossed over in the process. Now, we've had some less than forthright process as well with the formation of the removal corporation, KRRC. A colleague that you mentioned, Mr. Ed Sheets, who we had worked with to try and have our office and others be included in open hearings on what the KRRC was going to be doing going forward. And we did not have that forthright interaction with the elected member or the general public the way it should have. Indeed, secret meetings were held in this whole process. So I'm going to ask once again the secretary to withdraw the previous approval of the removal in this process and ask the secretary to put someone else as a facilitator up there in the Klamath system, because our people are not being heard. With that, I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Representative Gianforte.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member. And I want to thank the panelists for being here for your testimony. And Mr. Mickelson, as a fellow Montanan, a special welcome to you. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Mr. Heffling, you gave testimony today that based on the scientific data you have, there's a 97% survival rate through the dams of the salmon. We've also heard that we've seen record returns of adult salmon into the rivers. Based on the scientific data you have available to you and your opinion, is it your belief that the dams have virtually no impact on the salmon?
Yes, that would be correct. I mean, they have minute impact because there are small mortality rates, but that's in any river, no matter what obstacles they come up against. And I believe that the plans we have in place now definitely facilitate.
So virtually no impact on the salmon, the dams as they exist. Thank you. And Ms. Looney, I've met with members of the Montana Electric Co-ops who have talked to me about the ongoing problems with the Columbia River system. In Montana, we have about 130,000 families, farms, and ranches, small businesses that get their power from the Bonneville Power Administration, just as your customers do. These dams are one of the largest providers of carbon-free renewable energy in the area, and yet we continue to make them economically inefficient. And you testified yourself that costs are going up dramatically, $600 million a year, 37% increase by my calculation without compounding in rates. So my question is, we just heard that these dams have no impact on the salmon, and yet we have continuous litigation. What do you think the point of the litigation is? Is it about long-term viability of the salmon? We just heard the scientific data says that's not the reason. Is it that, or is it really just an attempt to remove all the dams?
Thank you, excellent question. I do have one of my members, Lincoln Electric Cooperative in Montana, so I think it depends on which party you're looking at. I think some do have an agenda for dam removal. I think some truly believe that the science that they are referring to is the accurate science. However, I believe that the federal science is the accurate science, and that federal science is what we'll be operating under if we can continue with this bill, and we'll be operating under that federal science as we do today until a new biological opinion is created after the NEPA process.
Okay. You also testified that an awful lot of money has been spent to improve these dams to negate any potential negative impact from on the salmon. Is it also your belief that the scientific data shows that these dams have virtually no impact on the salmon?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Keppen, ag is our number one industry in Montana, and I'm asking an obvious question, but for a farm or ranch that depends on irrigation water that might be diverted from one of these dams, if I've run a farm and I've relied on the irrigation water, you testified that, in fact, in certain cases, this water's turned off. Could you just describe the impact on a farmer of not getting irrigation water?
Sure, thanks. I think the first time I ever testified before one of these committees was after the 2001 water shutoff in Klamath Falls. I used to run the Klamath Water Users Association, which represents those irrigators. And it's terrible. I kind of mentioned it in my written testimony. I mean, not only are the farmers impacted, but the surrounding environment, the national wildlife refuges. There's a ripple effect that hits obviously the tractor suppliers, the fertilizer dealers, the business community. Tremendous rise in antidepressants that were prescribed by local pharmacists. And those were just the short-term impacts. I think in our community, it was about a $300 million impact in 1 year. Generally, ag right now creates about a $600 million boost to our economy. And then what I testified on back in 2002 before the Senate Energy and Natural Resources Committee was the lasting effects.
For an individual family farm who's dependent on water, for that family, what did they experience?
Oh, it's terrible. That's without water, you can't produce food. And some people were able to drill wells and have a backup supply that creates sort of a have versus have nots. It creates a terrible dynamic in the community. It's something I never want to go through again. And not only that, the following year, if you haven't irrigated and produced on your land, you've got weed problems, equipment that hasn't been used for a year. There's just a long range of impacts that last. It's not just like a one-year sort of an impact.
Great. Thank you. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Representative Newhouse.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank the members of the panel for coming here this morning and helping us through this important conversation about an issue that is of primary importance to my district. I represent the central part of Washington State. Many of these dams that we're talking about if they're not in my district, they certainly impact me directly. And so I want to thank everybody and everybody on the committee too, their interest in helping to solve this important issue. and certainly to welcome one of my constituents, Mr. Heffling. Appreciate your coming here and talking directly from your knowledge of these matters. He has an extensive background that I think is very important to this conversation, and thank you for that, as well as everyone else that brings their expertise this morning. So one of the drawbacks of being the last one to ask questions is that a lot of things have been asked already. They're very important, but just to, I guess, underscore some of the points that have been made. We all know that there's been a tremendous amount of scientific research that has gone into the successful passage of fish through dam structures, monitoring processes, lots of technologies that have increased the survival rates for these listed species, particularly in the Columbia River system. So, Mr. Heffling, could you, you've already made the point that that I think you said that dams and salmon can coexist. I think several people have made that point this morning. Could you, I guess I'd like to give you the opportunity to talk a little bit more about this ongoing debate that we have this morning about the 97% or 95 or 98% survival rate that we're experiencing right now that demonstrate to me the very successful coexistence of the fish in the dams. Is there anything else you'd like to add to that?
Yeah, just there's been a lot of talk, with all due respect to Ms. Hamilton, about increasing spill. And it's kind of, I kind of chuckle at that because we already have spill incorporated into the current biop. And I talked previously about supersaturation of nitrogen into the water. Right. Well, this has a cumulative effect through each of the dams that spill water. So right now, even though we are ordered to spill water for some augmentation and fish passage, we are limited by that dissolved gas is measured by the agency. And so we are limited our spill to where our dissolved gas levels are at. So even if there was some kind of order to increase spill, it couldn't be done without being incredibly dangerous to the fish. So I don't understand where some of this increased spill comes from, but it's not what works. The increase in fish survival has been multifunctional. It's been barging. It's been fish screens in the intakes of the turbines. It's been RSWs that they're actually a simple device. They're not Rube Goldberg at all. Right. They're very expensive devices, but they've been successful. So it's not spill that has really increased the survival rate. It's all the ways that we have improve the structures to pass fish, plus I'm a power plant operator myself and have to abide by the fish passage plan, which is based on the biop. So everything we do, whether what generator we start, at what level we run the generation, what spill we're at, all of this is according to this fish passage plan. It's meant for increased survival of fish. So we are doing everything possible to maintain that.
You know, the crux of the question here is the current biological opinion. Just for the record, would you agree that the current biop is working, that it's vital in order to support the federal Columbia River power system, as well as allowing salmon to continue recovering at their record rates that we see?
Oh, I would definitely agree that biop is what has actually worked, and that's why we have an increase in returns.
Good, appreciate that. And you know, there still are people talking about removal of the dams, particularly the Snake River dams. Could you talk a little bit from your experiences what it would take to replace these dams in as far as power generation, perhaps more nuclear, perhaps what other kinds of things that might be necessary?
Yeah, it's been just the lower Snake River dams. It would probably take two nuclear, maybe three coal-fired, six gas-fired power plants just to replace the annual power production. For peaking capacity, you're talking about three nuclear, six coal-fired, or 14 gas-fired power plants to provide just that peak capacity. But you know, these dams are more important than just what they can generate annually or whatever. They're one of these four plants are on the Snake River Columbia system are run under what BPA calls AGC, and that's automatic gain control. So peak power is not just a certain time of year, it's daily. When everybody gets up in the morning, turns their heat up, starts making their breakfast, the need for power rises way up there. In the evening when people come home from work, there are, you know. So that's what the main function of these dams are, is peak power. We go to full load in the morning, we go full load in the evening. You can't request wind, come on, blow harder because we need you right now. Right. And you can't say, well, come on, son, we need peak power right now. That can only be done by these type of projects.
So. Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. My time is up. I want to thank you for holding this hearing and also express my appreciation to Congresswoman McMorris Rodgers for her main sponsorship of this bill, and look forward to working with you.
All right. I'd like to thank all the witnesses for their valuable testimony. You've come a long way to be here, and I and all of us appreciate that. Members of the subcommittee may have additional questions for you, and we would ask that you respond to these in writing. Under Committee Rule 3-0, members of the committee must submit questions to the clerk within 3 business days following the hearing, and the hearing record will be open for 10 business days for these responses. If there's no further business, without objection, the committee stands adjourned.
Until summer. He's got to warm up a little bit. Warm up a little bit.
I have to wonder what David's doing.